In September 2021, China's broadcasting regulator issued a ban on Niangpao, or sissy men, from appearing on TV and video streaming sites. Popular boy band reality shows such as Idol Producer were cancelled, and TV dramas like Word of Honor were banned. The derogatory term is used to describe men with effeminate looks, ranging from wearing makeup and unisex clothing to having long hair and pierced ears. A month before the ban, an influencer blew up the Chinese internet with his feminine look and tone. His account was eventually suspended.
The Education Ministry's response to a top political advisor's call for more physical education to make boys more masculine has triggered fierce online debate.
什么叫男人？你们现在还不能称作是男人。
Do these rules signal a return to more traditional notions of patriarchy, masculinity, and nationalism, which includes control over gender, sexuality, and much more? Alibebe is a non-binary influencer based in Shanghai. They film makeup tutorials on their social media accounts. But after the ban on sissy men was announced in 2021, they claim that Douyin, the Chinese owners of TikTok, hid their public profile.
具体我不太记住了，可能是去年九月份的时候，他们就说你可能谋反了，违反了某项规定，然后怎么样，然后给你发99条规定，违反了其中一项，然后你要自己发现其实哪一项，没有怎么办，你就接受啊，就接受这件事情。今天准备穿这条裙子，我觉得画一个小烟熏。对，我当时发一个，我说我只是喜欢穿女装而已。 然后当时一个特别大的博主，B站一个很大的博主，百万博主吧，然后他加了我微信，然后他跟我说让我不要发那种，因为他也是一个变装博主。然后官方就是提醒他说最近不要发这种类似这种的视频。之前不是拍那个彩虹旗的那个一组图片，然后在小红书一直发不出去，你也不知道能不能会不会被限制，你露个沟也不行，你穿个 V 领的也不行。 不能穿抹胸不带肩带的，太多了。我回家形象就是很男生的形象，不知道我现在坐在这儿穿成这样，然后接受采访，不化指甲，不化妆，什么都不弄，然后衣服就是。
在家里待7天，可能都穿一套衣服，就是，就是营造一个很邋遢的直男形象吧。我为什么在我们中华文化这个国度，大家为什么反感娘炮？Peng
Xiaohui is a retired professor of sexology. He still gives lectures on his WeChat channel, where he opposes the culture of effeminacy.
Sissy man， 我们可以翻译过来就是阴阳气的男子，可以这么去翻译。我的意思就是说，娘炮文化不能成为一个国家的主流文化价值体系。娘炮文化的这些个案，它不能作为一个 idol， 青少年、未成年人，他会追星，他会抹杀掉自己男孩的那种天性，然后。 跟女性趋同，然后养成性格，他就是怕苦，怕危险，个案没有问题。你个案的选择我们也可以接纳他，但是你把这种男人的这种阳刚之气抹杀掉，作为一个国民性，一个国家如果是循着这个方向发展，意味着这个国家是自寻死路啊。 你看，为什么日韩娘炮文化是得到了美西方的支持啊？为什么？日韩是美国的殖民地啊，至少是半殖民地啊。他不要日本和韩国去反抗他呀。而美国和欧洲，他自己他的演艺界、他的文化，他并没有宣传娘炮文化呀。
他还是拯救大兵瑞恩呐、啊，他还是蜘蛛侠呀，他还是施瓦辛格演的那种，钢铁男人呐、啊。你这样的把男性的这种阳刚之气、那种反抗精神、那种尚武精神把它抹杀掉了的话，当然有利于美国统治日韩嘛，这个驻军日韩嘛，对不对？那么对应咱们中国，如果咱们中国的国民性全是娘炮文化的这种习性，是意味着什么？有人上战场吗？
Professor Peng is not alone in his views. Millions of Chinese netizens commented on the topic of sissy men. Gender studies expert Dr. Lin Sung believes that nationalism, patriotism, and masculinity have always been inextricably linked around the world.
There has definitely been this emergence of a dominant kind of hegemonic masculinity ideal, and that is associated with Chinese nationalism or patriotism. And that has been popularized with main melody or Zhuquan Lu films such as the famous Wolf Warrior series, where you have a very militant kind of muscular Chinese masculinity.That it is developed based on a kind of Hollywood prototype, this kind of savior image, but that has also been adapted to reflect China's ambitions in the world with its rise and its political power and its ambition to play a part on the international stage.
没有像国外一样，好像就是宣扬你要自己做自己或者什么的。中国是一个很传统的国家，很多人的想法还是很传统的，它确实是世代传承下来的一个精神。我以前会经常在网上发表一些评论呢、啊，我会说怎么样，包括跟为女性啊，或者是为少数群体啊，我一直说，然后就是跟一些人在评论里吵架什么，但我现在都不说了。我说你说这些有用吗？没有用的，你改变不了他任何的想法的。
Feng Zhexin once styled his hair long and wore earrings. Yet, when he graduated from university and started working at a state-run company, he decided to cut his hair and dress in a more masculine way, in line with company policy.
对于我来说，我是乐意承认我自己的身上有一些女性化的特质的。我觉得不一定是坏事。对于我的工作或者生活来说，我的心思会比别人。也不能说比别人更细腻，会有一些细腻的部分，有一些敏感的部分。当然这一方面，对我来说有的时候会有帮助，但有的时候也会有坏处。就好像我留长头发的那段时间，我自己觉得其实很满意，然后我对我那个时候自己的形象也很满意，但是确实在有一些时候会给你带来不便。在一些风气比较保守的环境或者是地域，你还是会感受到别人的视线，你知道那个视线是审视的，是打量的。高中毕业之后我就开始留长头发了，我从头发能扎起来之后我去打了耳洞，然后从那以后会有的时候会戴一些耳环或者耳钉。
来啦！
吃呗。我肯定潜意识里还是不太想让家，包括父母在内的家里的人看到的。包括其实不只是回家，可能去一些你知道比较保守的场合的时候，你也会注意。因为你不想因为这个事情引起别人过多的注意，或者你又需要解释为什么要这样。因为相对来说，留长发戴耳环的男性并没有那么常见。
Fan Chengcheng, the little brother of actress Fan Bingbing, took part in a boy band reality show, but was criticized online for being a sissy man.Sissy men in China aren't necessarily members of the LGBTQ community, but anti-sissy men policies add an extra layer of discrimination,
Sissyphobia in Western context are usually related to gay bashing. But in China, the Sissyphobia is not that specific to a certain group of sexual minorities. It reflects a larger concern over the crisis of masculinity in the country's male population. I would say that the ban of Sissy men on Chinese television or live streaming has an impact on the country's LGBTQ community because it is an act that attempts to discipline gender expressions. And it definitely has caused more homophobic reactions among people.
The open-ended interpretations of the bans and mixed messages from government bodies leaves effeminate men unsure of how best to express themselves.
我觉得人也很难说自己没有刻板印象，也很难离开刻板印象。偏见一定会有的，只是你对待偏见的态度。我告诉你说我不是，我没有，那你相不相信，或者你尊不尊重我？我觉得 是比偏见更有没有偏见更重要的问题。我觉得反对男性女性化的这个议题很容易和恐同扯到一起去，但实际上是两件完全不同的事情。我会觉得发布这个通知很令人无语，就是有一种奇怪的感觉，就是说的通俗一点，你骂谁呢？可能有我在我个人来说，我不会觉得在说我，但我也不太知道他在说谁。说实话，如果你要有一个通知，有一个政策，有一个规定，那你要具体规定好，什么样算娘炮，什么样不算，什么样叫你要禁止的所谓娘炮到底是什么样的？现在说的太模糊。
而且我觉得年龄大之后真的不是自信了，是无所谓，有一种 don't give a fuck 的感觉。就是以前你会觉得说，哎呀，我在意别人怎么看我，在意别人怎么说我，就你心里很害怕别人老 judge 你或者是怎么怎么样。现在你都无所谓了，我觉得年龄到你越年龄越大，你越不在乎这些事情。
In China, there's a clash between more liberal and international opinions and traditional patriotic mindsets, with Sissy men being the latest in many flashpoints.
我们还是要培养男孩像男孩，女孩像女孩。我们就从中国的这个独有的文明体系、独有的文化、独树一帜的文化体系来讲，我们要保存中华文化的这个绵延的话，我们要有男人。没有男人，中华文化一定会消亡。因为西方的个人主义和自由主义以及对抗性的民主政治，它时时刻刻在虎视眈眈。我们是和文化，我们是中庸文化，我们是求同存异文化，我们可以海纳百川，可以接纳所有的无害于社会的所有的要素，但并不意味着我们一定要按照美西方的那种所谓的性别政治意识形态正确去打造我们的文化体系和社会结构。我们要保持我们自身的社会发展的阶段性。
Despite the official bans and patriotic viewpoints, the Sissy men subculture still has a place in Chinese society, buoyed by capitalism rather than communism.
I would say that while these bans and official backlash against people with non-normative gender expressions is definitely creating a worse environment for those quote-unquote Sissy men in China, I do think that there are space for hope for the existence of Sissy men in China. This long-standing kind of soft masculinity ideal that has been circulating in the East Asian area for two decades, I do not think that they would simply die out because of a directive or a ban or a commentary from official media.